I've not caught up with you actually since, well, we have caught up, but I've not spoke to you properly on the video about Brian passing away recently. Mm. Now, obviously your relationship, Brian, goes without saying, and his impact on your life and your boxing career and this gym where we are now. I just like to speak to you really and get your chance on camera to pay tribute to the man. I know you have many times over the years, but this is going to be a standalone video, your memories and your tribute to Brian.
Regardless what anyone's got to say, regardless what anyone's got to think, I love Brian through and through. I respected Brian through and through. And regardless what people said, if I had my way and it was different, I would have been with Brian every step of the way through his illness. And certain things didn't go the way it should have been. And I still went to the funeral to pay my last respects. And as far as I'm concerned, regardless what anyone says, I will carry his legacy and keep his legacy going on through Collier Aston Mostyn by letting people know that it was Brian that built this gym and we're just keeping it going. It was Brian that taught me how to become a big trainer, a good trainer. It was Brian that taught me how to do a cut. Yeah. And you don't see many trainers do it now by just holding it together, and then putting the agenda in, just using your fingers to stop a cut. It's very rare, or using the towel. To hold the towel and putting the finger in it, and I did it a different way now. I used the pad. We have a square pad and I put the German on it, and instead of using the towel where Brian used to put it at the end of the towel, I used the square cotton pad and squeeze it in, the soft one, not the gore one, the cotton one, and that just squeezes the German in. It also does what the towel does. It holds it together and it stops the blood. All these little things is what I remember watching Brian and him telling me to come in. So everything that I've learned in this game, plus added from where he sent me to the States and everything else, is I just want to be not like him, but just as good as him, because we're two different people on a different path. What I want to be, have the same respect as what he had in boxing, go the same way, produce champions from nothing, from scratch, taking on certain fighters and bringing them in and guiding them to the top, as he did with Robbie Reed and Michael Jennings and Matty Hall, that he didn't actually train from young with me, Tommy McDonough, Craig Dermody. He trained us from scratch, from absolutely nothing to where we were today, taught us how to punch. And that's the kind of knowledge that I've had doing it with Zelfa and Lyndon, Matthew Ryan and other fighters that I've got by myself in here. And including the only kid that I've took on that's absolutely sensational in this gym is a kid called Amar Akbar. He's one that I think will go all the way, that I've only just started training from being a professional. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. I was speaking to Michael Jennings recently about Brian as well, and he says, every day he'll think there'll be something in his everyday life where he'll revert back to Brian, or some kind of, in the training or in life, some saying he had or something he did in training, he'll always have him, that's pretty much like you, because I know you've said in here a lot of times some of the things you say, like, swatting a fly with a jab and all them kinds of things, it was all stuff that, Brian put into use.
You're never going to forget what you've been taught. It's like being a parent, teaching you how to get by in life. As long as you're the person to listen, and I mean, I wish I would have listened to Brian a lot more in life, which I didn't, because the minute you stop listening is that's when the time when you stop progressing. And I think that's what happened with me in my career, because I finished at the age of 28. I lived too much of the other half of life, but when I come back and I think about it, I realise it, that he was right in everything he said. And if I can just, like I just said, it's one thing that I know that is I'm never forgetting what he said to me, that he says, you're going to be a good coach, you. And he said, you're going to be like someone like Emmanuel Stewart, because the fact that you've got the respect from the fighters and you know how to get into the heads straight away, that says a lot about you. And that was the main thing. It wasn't even anything about when I was fighting. It was just one main thing when he compared me to one of the greatest trainers and said, I could be like that. Yeah, that's making me think, even from now, I believe in myself as a trainer. I really do, more than anything. Yeah, and I'm not saying I'm not everybody's cup of tea, which I'm not. Some people might not like my methods. Some people might not like what I say or do, how I do it. But there's one thing that I can say is I know how to get into a fighter's head. I know how to motivate a fighter. I know how to make a fighter have disdain. And I know how to make a fighter want to kill a man. what I mean? And that's the fact of the matter, is what you can do. And when you can't do that, you can't move them, then you can't do your job, and you've got nothing in common. Because a great trainer needs to be rewarded with a great fighter, and you need a teamwork. I tell you what you're doing wrong, you find a way to resurrect it and put it right. I show you how to do it. You listen, you learn, you find a way of doing it and transforming it into the way you know how to do it. That's what we do together. We work together as a team. Once that team stops working, then you've got nothing. It's like a relationship. You have to respect each other and love each other and trust each other. Yeah, and then you've got a great team. And if you haven't got that with any fighter, or you haven't got that in your relationship at home, you haven't got a marriage. Yeah, and I've got that with all my fighters, even the ones that are taken. I always interview them, I always talk to them first, see how I can relate with them. If I can relate with them, I can work with them, I can get on with them, with a team.
You and Tommy still keep the gym running and buzzing. I mean, it's you know, it's that capacity on the amateur night, and it's you know, it's always busy with the pros now, and it's getting busier and busier. So it was like really an important thing for both of you to keep that going and to.
It's different, really, because what Tommy does, I couldn't do with the amateurs, coming and going, a lot of messing about. But what I do, Tommy wouldn't do, because it's a lot of time progressing. Fighters wanting to turn pro with you, next thing you know, they want to pack it in. So it's hard on both of us, but with a good team, me and Tommy. When the lads don't have to look far when they want to turn pro, I'm loving it, you know, doing what I'm doing.
I just wanted a quick chat. I'm sure these, you know, we could be here all day speaking about Brian, and then some we have over the years, I'm sure we will again, some of the stories. But just to finish, you know, if there was an abiding thing for you that sticks with you about Brian that you could share, and you know what embodies the man and the coach, what would that be?
He believed in me. That was the key. That's what I'm here today. If he was the only person out of everybody in this earth, on this land, that believed in me. Yeah. As I went to get my trainer's license, it took me 5 years. He made me not give up on it and kept going back. He believed in me. Because he said, when you do get it, it's going to be worth it. He's saying was, look, here's what it is, Patrick. He's talking, Patrick. He says, listen, if you put a ton load of sugar on a bit of shit, underneath it, it will always be shit. So no matter how much sugar you put on top of it, it's going to be shit. And that's the same with these people at this board, Pat. They're going to keep fucking doing the same thing with you. But you go back, son. And when you do go back and you get it, fuck them. And here I am now, after this time. Because when somebody teaches you how to believe in yourself and not to give up and not to quit. In life, the easiest thing is to do is to quit. The hardest thing is to persevere and find a way of winning. And I always do it the hardest way. Because nobody never thought I would make it in the promoting game. 7 years now, Chris. And everyone thought I would have wrapped up. But I'm still searching for that world champion. Because I'm a dreamer. And I'll keep dreaming until I produce a couple of world champions. And that's the path, and that's what keeps me going on. And that's what keeps me alive today, because of this and what I believe in.
Well, Tommy, Brian, you passed away, your trainer, a mentor in your life as well, a very prominent figure in your life, your boxing career. Passed away recently, you know, rest in peace, Brian. He did a lot for the community, a lot for boxing, a lot for you personally. And I'd just like to give you this chance to, you know, us to speak on camera about Brian, really.
Yeah. Well, obviously, off camera, we've done a lot of talking out with Chris about Brian, you know, the stories, the fun, you know, the learning. I've got to that point now with Brian, with the situation with Brian is, I always talk about Brian in everything that I do. It's crazy, you know, some of the advice that he gives me, just really he must have just, I don't know, it just it's like as if he gave that advice and it was personally going to me. Do you get what I mean? Like, oh, always be nice to people, son. And, you know, there's things like that, you know, just things that I pass on to my own kids even. Do you know what I mean? And just how he was. Just a top guy. And the last time I seen Brian, spoke to him, It was just summed him up in 5-10 minutes, because he wasn't well, obviously, and he didn't recognise me. But loads of times we'd be places and people come up to go, hi Brian, And it's mad because I find myself people letting on to me now, and if someone goes, "Who's that?" and I go, "I haven't got a clue." And that's what Brian was like. And all the time he'd go, "Oh, hello, son. How you doing? How's your mum? Oh, you know." And then he'd just be talking to it, and then I go, "Brian, who's that?" and he go, "I don't know. Like, not got a clue." No little daft things like that. But he was always really polite to people. Do you know what I mean? "Are you looking well?" Do you know what I mean? And you get some people who would think, "Wow, he's not looking. He's looking awful. He's put weight on." Do you know what I mean? And he'd be like, "You're looking well, son." Doing all that. Yeah. I used to just be laughing.
You saw the funny side of that. We didn't recognise you.
Yeah, but he did. Was it was mad because I'd seen him doing it to hundreds of people, and obviously never rude, never rude. He was always, "Oh, are you, son? You okay? You alright?" I go, "Oh, God." Some referees, "Hey, Brian. Oh, how are you, son? Oh, you're doing well," and all that. And they go, "How's your name, Brian?" I go, "I don't know who he is." And it was just always like a running thing with him. And he was genuine. He genuinely didn't know who he was. But he, Pat said, had him in the car, and Pat said to him, "You know Tommy, don't you, Brian? But you always call me Thomas." And he went, "Oh, of course I know Johnny," like that. Oh, I was gutted. And he was like, he's just being like, "Oh, how are you doing, son?" He was giving me that spiel like he'd give to other people. And I thought, wow, you don't even know who I am. And then we always have a laugh all the way through. It was always back in the 80s, late 80s when I first joined, it was full of like Irish Gomez, "Oh, Michael, be Jesus," and all that. And Thomas, "Oh, be Jesus," and all that stuff. And obviously all the black lads like Pat, Dell, Ricky Burton, Mark Levy. So, do you know what I mean? It was all that firm, it was all us. And he go, "Oh, you know what them black fellas are like, so Tom," or to Patrick, do you know what I mean? And never racist, never anything like that. You got to watch what you say now on camera, but it was never racist. It was always real fun, do you know what I mean? Yeah. And I said to him, because Pat was taking for some food, and I said, "Hey, Brian, make sure he pays," and all that. And I went, "You know what them black fellas are like, don't you, Brian?" No, because Pat was there. So me and Pat started laughing. And Brian just started chuckling, started proper laughing. And then he went to me, "Hi, Thomas," like that. I swear to God, he went, "Hi, Thomas," like that, looked at me. And Pat was there. And Ben, there's a picture. There's a couple of pictures of Ben Mulligan was there. Who else was there? Matthew Ryan, the picture outside.
Got a few of them.
Yeah, and that's what he's talking, that and he goes, "Hi, Thomas." I went, "How you doing, Brian?" He went, "How many kids you got now?" And my little son was only about 18 months or something. I went, "I've got two daughters, Brian," because Lois wasn't born. I said, "I've got two daughters, Brian, and I got my little boy." And he went, "He's going to be a champion. He's going to be like you." He went, he's like going, "Look at your shoulders now, son." No, not that. So I was like, getting a big heart right now, and I laugh at him. He going, you are, and all that. He went, "So how old's your lad?" But I had a little, so I said to him, he said, "He's like nearly two, Brian." He went, "Get him in that gym and all that stuff." So I said, "Brian, what advice have you got for the boys?" You know, like that. I went, "Brian, what advice have you got for the boys?" And he went, "Honestly, cool." He went, "See that door there?" Or the front door downstairs. I've told you this, Anna, before. He went, "See that door there?" He said, "There's three locks on that door." Like that. And he went, "Every lock, you've got to open it and then you move on to the next one. And you open that and you move on to the next one." He said, "And that's like life is, son. You've got to keep opening them doors and keep trying to move to the next level." Like that. I went, "Oh, yeah, Brett." And I thought, because there's three locks on that door, do you know what I mean? And just went like that, and just that was it then. Yeah. I went, "Innit, Brett?" He went, "Yeah, son." And I thought, "Oh, fucking hell." But it was just nice, that little not even five minutes, 2 minutes, he just snapped in and snapped out. And I just thought, wow. It was sad, but like I say, I started boxing at 8, retired at 30. And then obviously I was in Brian sort of like left the gym 2011. So from 1988 2011, 23 years, seen him pretty much on average 5 days a week, do you know what I mean? And I never forget Brian. Brian was a proper character. And he sometimes, honestly, God, sometimes, very rarely, I will wake up like in the middle of the night. It's happened to me a few times. You wake up and think, oh, I wonder what he's got planned for me today. And then I think, no, because that was my life, just boxing. Do you know what I mean? Like, even when I was at school, I didn't go to school, I just wagged it. And I was training here all the time. I was training here all the time as a kid. And so it was just boxing all my life, training. What's Brian got planned for me, kind of thing. And then sometimes I realise, I mean, wow, no, I'm not a boxer anymore, kind of thing. And it's like,
it's lingering,
but it's just that. Do you know what I mean? Even just to, you know, drinking and all that stuff like that. I when I drink, I like to have a couple of drinks, but like, I regiment myself, kind of thing, where I'll say, right, I'm not gonna do this for 8 weeks. I'm not gonna drink beer for 8 weeks. Do you know what I mean? I drink seldom, but I think I'm not gonna drink for 8 weeks. I'm gonna give that up. I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna do that. Do you like? But little things like, I don't know, it's just, I try hard to explain it, but little things that, little challenges.
Yeah, like when you're a boxer, yeah, to do that. Yeah.
Little challenges. Sacrifices. You know, like just things, and I think, right, and then back it, honestly, as long as they can't, I think, Brian would be glad if I did this. You know, that kind of thing. Yeah, yeah. You know, when you're running, I'm running a marathon in a couple of weeks, and I'm like, thinking, I'm going to do this. You know what I mean? The odd time where I'm struggling, I think, ah, I've sat that. Do you know what I mean? Like, Brian would have been like, come on, son, don't give up. No, little daft things. It's just mad. It's just, I can't explain it.
Motivator.
Yeah. Like, obviously, my kids know who Brian is. My Thomas knows who Brian is. Do you know what I mean? Thomas is 7. Thomas never met Brian in his life. My Lucy and Lola know exactly who he is. Do you know what I mean? Like, it's because they hear me talk about him regular. Do you hear me talk about him, say, you know, little things like that. Brian helped me, advised me to get my own house when I was a kid. Little daft things. We come from a council house. None of my family owned houses. No, I could get no advice. Do you know what I mean? Obviously, my wife and stuff, but Brian, get your own house, son. Little daft thing, forget the cars. Get a nice house. Trust me, do this, do that. Do you know what I mean? No, don't. Honestly, like, I could be here all day, Chris. I literally could be here all day. There was another something that happened. What happened? I had a story that last time I seen him, but I got some proper stories. Do you know what I mean? Like, just it was just when he died, like, because obviously we've not seen him for years and whatever. Obviously it was sad, but I just try and think that he's kind of like still about. Do you get what I mean? I try not to dwell on it that much. Do you know what I mean? Because it's sad. Do you know what I mean? And then we're just gonna keep the club going, as you all know, as that's what we always talk about, and that's all we all we've ever wanted to do. You know, we even talk about this. You know, some of the school kids we have in the club. That's come from Brian. That's come from how Brian was with us as kids. Do you know what I mean? How I treat them kids. I treat them with respect, and they treat me with respect. Do you know what I mean? I don't sit there shouting and screaming at them. Do you know what I mean? I shout and scream at my own kids, and they don't listen to me, so that doesn't work. So, you know, it's just a little lot about Brian. You know, Brian had that a presence about him. You know, not a big boisterous man, or just small, little chubby fella. Do you know what I mean? And he carried presence. He carried that. When he'd listen, he'd talk to you. Come here, son. Pull you to one side. Come here. Don't do that. Do this. Or listen to me. Do you trust me? Yeah. I find myself saying it now to these kids because obviously, you know, I'm 41 now, and I know what's going to happen to certain kids. You know, do you know what I mean? I know what's going to happen to certain adults on how their lives are going to pan out. You sort of like can call it. It's it just repeats itself, doesn't it? And Brian used to tell me, listen, son, don't do this, because this will happen. Don't do this, this could happen. And oi, I won't go into detail, but he told me about, it's weird, he told me about 5-6 different people, I won't mention the names. He told me 5-6 different people, maybe more over the years, of what they would end up doing and how they'd end up living their lives. Well, nailed it. Nailed every single one of them. He went, he'll end up doing this, he'll end up doing that, he'll end up this way, he'll end up that way. Honestly, I'm talking like, wow. Like, could you just read him like that? Do you know what I mean? I won't know what he was saying about me. how I'd end up. Do you know what I mean? I hope it was good. He's just there. He's a good guy. And like you say, the sad thing about it was, Brian's probably best attribute was his mind, wasn't it? How he talked to you and do you know what I mean? He wasn't like, even when he was teaching boxing, he'd show you a little bit, but he wasn't really what's the word? He taught you through it. Does that make sense? So he was all his, everything that he did, he taught you through it. He broke it down to you in a different way. Do you know what I mean? So, you know, even when you was driving, you're driving up the street and he'd go, see that car there, son, that could have been a left up coming. You've got to be aware, he's always that, do you know what I mean? So, you know, you're driving and he's referred it back to boxing. Do you know what I mean? And so it was a shame that obviously towards the end that it was his mind that went really. So Brian Hughes, legend, mate, always will be. The kids in this gym, as long as I'm alive, they'll know who Brian is. Whether people like that or not, I don't care. But you know, Brian will continue to coach them. Good left jab, good defence. As long as they've got that, the rest is down to them. We'll teach them a good left jab, we'll teach them a good defence. Obviously, we'll teach them other stuff. But as long as they've got them two fundamentals and the rest of them, like Brian says, a lot of the time, the ability, natural ability, it can't be taught. You just gotta teach them the basics and then just go and be you. Just go and enjoy it. You go and do what you think. You're the guy. You're in there. You can read the fight just as much as anyone. Do what you think you should be doing. Things like that. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. Apart from that time when I was getting hit with right hands and it was really hurting me. And he kept telling me to. So Brian is hurting me. He went, would you give over? Started spraying the water in my eye. And he's just, you know. So it's, I'm glad we've had this chat. I've been wanting to have a chat with you about it. I've been wanting to talk about Brian. I could sit here and talk about Brian and everyone is just like, do you know when you're telling a story? Yeah? And people listen. When I tell them stories about Brian, they listen. It's crazy. But I used to see my dad, when Brian would speak, listen to him. Does that make sense? So you got your dad, who obviously I respect my dad, love my dad, but my dad, when Brian would speak, my dad would listen. He'd be engrossed. He'd be like, oh, what do you think Brian said then? Brian, what do you think, Tricky's going to be good? Oh. Do you know what I mean? My dad would listen to Brian. Do you get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It's like, he was that guy. People respected him, people listened to him. And he was liked. Yeah, Brian, he was funny. Every single person you speak to about Brian, I've got a funny story to tell you.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? How he sometimes, he'd get you to do things, right? And that you didn't want to do, but he knew you'd end up liking it. Do you get what I mean? And he'd go, I bet you're glad you did it now. And I'd go, yeah. Do you know what I mean? So he'd get to know that person and he'd get to, he'd get the best out of you. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, yeah. Mr. Hughes,
I'm glad I've had this chat with you as well, Tom. I mean, like I said to Pat there, we could speak forever, couldn't we, about some of the stories and the things, the influence that Brian's had on boxing and, like we said, on people's lives, personally on your life as well, but you know, in your boxing career as well, just to finish, if there's one, I was speaking to Mike Jennings, he told me a funny story when he was in the corner with Brian and how he used to, you know, his traditional methods of getting it across, if you like. If there was one moment in a corner that, you know, typifies Brian's character and his spirit and, you know, who he was, it, during the, one of your fights, what was it, if you can think of a moment?
Do you know what? We had a couple, yeah?
Give us a couple.
One of them where... He, how are you feeling, son? And I'd go, I think it was boxing Bradley Price, and Carl Lynch said to me, because you can't move a decent shot, Bradley Price, and Carl Lynch, when I went back to the corner, Carl Lynch said, what round is it? No, to me, but I knew full well what round it was, so I went, it was round 10, so I went, is it round three? And Brian looked at me like, and Brian knew that I was laughing, squirting me in the face, and went, would you give up? So I just started laughing to myself, and it was like this, because it was a decent shot, but I knew exactly where it was, you know what I mean? And Brian knew, do you know what I mean? Brian knew me better than Carl did, so Carl went, what round is it? I went, is it round three? Like that, go straight away, innit? And Brian went, would you give over on the spray to finger me? I bought another one, Delroy Mellis, I boxed him. And I was only a little skinny kid, you can remember. And Delroy Mellis, I think he'd had like 20 fights or something. I think he'd won 10, lost 10. But the fights that he won, he chinned them all, didn't he? Do you remember Delroy Mellis? Proper tough kid. Yeah. And I swear, the next day after my fight, when I boxed him, all my arms was dead. Because he was winging me, do you know what I mean? And I remember all the way in, he was all like, Ilson, son, get behind that jab, beautiful boxing, all that, no, full of confidence, just like this, do you know what I mean? And while they're shouting the names out and this and that, and he gave me the drink and he's like, go on, son, beautiful boxing, easy this and all that. And anyway, go on, be yourself and all that. And then as we went to meet each other in the thingy, this Derek Mellis give me like dirty looks and stuff, like proper wanted to chin me, do you know what I mean, before the fight's even started. I'm thinking, he means business, this guy. And you see Brian go like that. Ooh, Thomas, now listen to me. He's going to try and knock you out. Get your hands up. And he's getting out of the ring and he's going, get your hands up. But he's panicking, you know that. He's not panicking, but he's like, he's changed his mood now. At first it's like, oh, this will be easy, this. And then as soon as he sees him, he goes, do you know what I mean? And I remember just like, I half laughed to myself, but thinking, and this is Delroy Mellis, he's banging his hands like this, he's ready to give it me. And Brian was, it was just funny, it was just one of them. On my debut when I boxed
Lee... How did that fight go with Delroy Mellis?
I beat him, but mate, he honestly. the wind was coming past me, I was like, oh, getting out of here. But when I boxed Lee Molyneux on my debut, I'm obviously nervous. And it was fantastic on my debut. I had all the old boys come back and watch me. Mark Levy and all them all walked me in, and obviously Pat and everyone. It was dead good, do you know what I mean? Because I was like, they knew me from being a kid. And but Lee Molyneux, I was like, obviously, you know, he's Sky Sports are there and all that. I'm thinking, yeah, made it here now, man. Do you know what I mean? And they go and meet each other. Next thing, Brian and Lee Molyneux, because Lee messages me every now and again. And Brian and Lee Molyneux just started chatting. Hey, Brian. Oh, hi Lee, how you doing, son? And they're both chatting to each other. Do you know what I mean? Like, in the middle of the ring. And I'm thinking, I'm supposed to be fighting this guy, and you're chatting to him like normal. He's going, hey, Brian, you okay? Do you know what I mean? Because obviously at that time, you know, I'm thinking, this is a big, big fight. This is why it's my debut, do you know what I mean? But obviously, it was all on a learning curve, wasn't it? But so Brian wasn't fazed at all. But there's loads of stories, honestly, loads of stories. But in the changing rooms, I used to love... Obviously, my mum and mum and dad, they panic and all that. We have, like I say, 66 amateur fights, 40 pro fights. So the ritual was quite the same, how the day went, do you know what I mean? We're Catholics, we say loads of prayers and all that stuff. Not like over-the-top prayers, but do you know what I mean? And my mum's really like, holy water, this, and don't panic. Like, listen to me, son. If he hurts you, just don't have to worry about anything. If he hurts you, you know, tell Brian that he's hurt, you know, and all that kind of stuff. I just think, and I couldn't wait to leave the house. I couldn't wait to see Brian. Do you get what I mean? The second I seen Brian, here he is. Now listen, son, am I wasting my time today? What, are you gonna listen? Yeah, of course. And he just relaxed me, do you know what I mean? Mm. And obviously I'd take it to another level. I'd be laughing and joking and giddy, if you can remember me in the change rooms. Because I remember Brian saying to me, no one's making you do this. Boxing, no one's making you do it. You're doing it because you want to do it. So enjoy it and embrace it. Do you get what I mean? Like, it does do my head in, because obviously I'm involved in a boxing with the amateurs. It does my head in when I see kids, grown men, when they're fighting, they've got a fight lined up or come fight, and they're nervous. Now, that sounds wrong when I say that, but what I mean by that is like overly nervous. Everyone gets nervous. I got nervous, everyone gets nervous. But no one overly nervous where they can't eat, where they're proper. And I think, how do you put yourself through that? Do you know what I mean? I'm thinking, you know, how would you put yourself through that? Like, it must be really, really stressful for you, because you're actually nervous, like scared. And I see it, there's only a couple of people I see, where Brian say to me, enjoy it. Say to all the lads, enjoy it, you're here for a reason. You want to do this, no one's making you do it. It's not as if, like, you got to go, he's never said this, but it's not as if you got to go to the war and you don't want to go. Do you get what I mean? It's like, boxing is something that you want to do. You've asked for this fight, you've asked for to do this. Now you're here, so go and do it and enjoy it. Do you get what I mean? And that's what I used to love being when he was with Brian. He'd be like, come on, son, let's go. And you're on at 7 o'clock, you're on at 12 o'clock. Doesn't matter, he used to go. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter what time you're on at. We're not going anywhere. Do you know what I mean? And then another, like, when they try and rush you, like, I always say it to the kids now, you're on next. And I go, they won't start without us. And Brian say to us, they can't start without us. I think, obviously they can't start without us, you know what I mean? Yeah. So little daft things, I always say it to the boys. I said it the other week in Robbie Reed, that's Brian Hughes' thing now, because I went, they can't start without us like that. No, because one of my guys getting in, he's panicking, my kid, oh, I need to get on now. I said, oh, chill out, they can't start without us. And that's what Brian would do, he'd just calm you right down. Do you know what I mean? And he'd stick up for you. You know, against, like, officials and against whoever, he'd stick up for you. He, you know, you just seen him that time with Kerry Hope and that with Matty Hall, with Kerry Hope up in Wales, and all that fight and the whole shenanigans what went around that. But he'd back you. Do you get what I mean? And he'd want what's best for you, and he wouldn't change the goalpost, Brian. Brian wouldn't change the goalpost. You know, he never did with me. He never did. He was fair. He was he kept his word, and that's what, you know. Yeah. That's what I like about him. Do you know what I mean? I mean, I had some really good, honestly, Chris, it's dead corner, but the best time of my life was them days. Do you know what I mean? And I genuinely believe that from 96 to 2005, maybe, let's just say 2006, they was the best times. That 10 years was when he was, I think, when he was at his peak as well, when he was like bang at it, when he was just, Brown's always been good, but he was just, his knowledge, his everything just come, you know what I mean? And that was around about the time that we was all coming through. So we cop lucky. Do you get what I mean? Like, I think Pat, towards the beginning, and the Pat be on a, like, journeyman shows, and do you know what I mean? And coming through the hard gear, they sort of like done all the hard graft, which then paved the way for us, didn't it? Do you know what I mean? And then I got to live that and box all the big bills and see famous people and be around that kind of life. Do you know what I mean? Mm. And like I say, Brian was bang on it. Sum up a fight. 2 minutes. I'm going to tell you this last one, and they go, Martin Monaghan, oh, he was solid. He was proper solid. I remember getting told I was boxing him. I remember thinking, he's boxed Garth Rock him. Thinking, he boxed Garth Rock at super middleweight. How can he make light middleweight? No chance. He's got it wrong. And he had a top fight with Gary Lockett. He had two good fights with Gary Lockett, didn't he? Mm. And really, really good fights. I think the first one was really close. And I remember thinking, he's a proper unit, this guy. And I seen him at the weigh-in, and I was 11 stone one, and he was like 11 stone one and a bit, and he was massive. Do you know what I mean? Like, when I used to box, I boxed a couple of guys, and like, I'd be taller than them. They'd be like that, but I'd be taller than them. Or, you know, do you get what I mean? Like, how can I say it? Like you could see that I was a bit taller, they was a bit smaller, that's why we were both 11 stone, whereas this Martin Monaghan, he was big. He was as big as I was, height-wise, but he was thick set than me, I thought. And he was proper solid, Martin. And I remember the first round, this is probably one of the only times I really, really listened to Brian, because I had to. The first round, he come right at me, and he was giving it, mate. And I remember him. I remember having me in the corner. I remember thinking, I tried to get out, and he wasn't. He was physically strong. Like when he grabbed me, or when I grabbed him to tie him up, kind of thing. He was physically strong, and I can remember him. Remember Brian Hughes going to step back to the corner. Brian Hughes went, "Now listen, honestly, I swear to God." He went, "Now listen. You don't listen to me this time, you're going to get knocked out." That's what he said. He went, "You're going to get knocked out." He said, "This guy is strong." He said, "What are you doing?" He said, "You're backing up." He said, "You're backing up." He said, "You're giving him full leverage of his punches." He said, "You carry on backing up against this guy." He said, "He's going to chin you." I'm thinking, I mean, what should I do then? No, as I say, like, he's coming at me. I'm thinking, I'm boxing him and move. He went, no. He went, "You've got to take him on the gloves. So you've got to push him back a bit." He went, "But you're good enough to do that, son. You can do it." Because I'm looking at him thinking, it's a bit suicide, that. Because this guy's strong. He's whacking me. And you know what I mean? So, oh, fucking hell. And I was genuinely, I listened because I thought, because he was hurting me a little bit, do you know what I mean? And he was strong. He was, like I say, when I grabbed him, he thrown me off. And he was having none of that tying him up stuff. Like, I just go, bop, bop, tie him up. He wasn't having it. He was thinking, nah, no way. And he thrown me off and he's winging me. Anyway, second round, come out, took him on the gloves, and I pushed him back a little bit, and it was easier. Do you know what I mean? And I went back, and Brian went, "That's exactly what you got to do, but you can't switch off of him. That's what you got to do." And it was just mad how he changed that little tactic, and he made my life a lot easier. That night was, because I couldn't have gone through another 5-6 rounds of that. I think it was only a 5-6 rounder or an 8 rounder. And it was a good fight. It was a good scrap. And I think the boxing news gave me a little bit of praise for once and said, "Oh, you done well, McDonough." It was a really good fight, because, like I say, I took him on the gloves and I just backed him up. And when I put him on the back foot, he wasn't as strong and he wasn't as good. So it was a real learning curve for me. Do you know what I mean? Where sometimes, you know, you got the bull and the matador, the bull attacks the matador and he gets off. Whereas, obviously, that's how you take it. You know, with big punches, you think, "Oh, I'm just going to box him and move." But that's how he took it, his advantage. You know what I mean? It was good, and that's why, moving on, that's why someone like say Canelo can beat Triple G, can't he? Because he can take his power and he can back him up a little bit. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? And as the years go on, you think, wow. And Brian, that advice was like, wow. I remember actually on the way out hugging him and saying, "Brian, thanks, mate," and all that. And he was like, "Oh, you listen to me, son. You box really well then." And he gave me that. He was honest. You know what I mean? He gave me a bit of praise. "You box really well then." He said, "It was a good fight, that, son. You listened and you done what you had to do." Do you know what I mean? So, yeah, the list goes on, mate. I'd be here all night telling you about Brian.
Yeah, as you know, it'll be good stories. I mean, I'm sure he's had a great laugh. You know what you're like as well, and what Brian was like. Yeah. Some of them great times over the years, Tommy. And thanks for sharing them stories.
No problem.
Appreciate it.
Hopefully, do it again.
To you. We will do it again.
I'm going to let you go now. Sometimes sit at home and think, I need to tell Chris that, you know, some proper funny moments.
Well, we'll do it. Every so often, we'll do some Brian Hughes stories, yeah.
And, yeah.
You know, passing that knowledge on to Brian as well. So I'm sure people got a few things off this video, you know, of learning about. I mean, I like hearing about the old guys, and especially someone who's. Yeah. Who had a lot about them like that, Brian. So Brian, I'm sure other people will enjoy it, mate.
Brian should go, "Oh, he's a Frankie Howard him." "What does that mean, coward?" Do you know what I mean? "He's a Frankie Howard him." "What does that mean, bro? He's a coward him, trust me, coward." Do you know what I mean? And like, he told me that Tyson Fury, 2008, 2009, he said to me, "Tyson Fury, he's going to be heavyweight champion of the world." That's what he said. Yeah. And at that time, Tyson Fury was a young boy, young, you know.
When he came here, Tyson, to the gym, didn't he?
And Brian went, "Be champion of the world, Thomas. Be heavyweight champion of the world." I went, "I was driving," I thought. "Say that about Scott Quigg." He went, "Champion him, Tom." And I went, "Remember?" I went, "Do you reckon, Brian?" He went, "Oh, without doubt." He went, "Without doubt, you'd be heavyweight champion of the world." Because at the time, you got to remember Klitschko and all, him were dominating and all that. Mm-hmm. Lennox Lewis was just sort of like retired kind of thing. And you had both the Klitschkos. And I remember thinking, phew. And then, wow. Mm-hmm. Say about Scott Quigg. Scott Quigg had about 10 amateur fights. Seen Scott Quigg in here. And I actually thought, I said this to Scott the other week at the funeral, said, "Here's what he said about you." He went, "Did I?" I went, "Yeah." And I went, "I didn't believe him when he said to me he's going to be a world champion." I thought, "Brian, turn it in." Do you know what I mean? Because Scott wasn't Brian's kind of fighter kind of thing. Brian liked his good jab, good defence. Scott had them, by the way, but what I mean is Scott was more rugged and hard working. Do you get what I mean? And Scott would say Scott's best skill was his commitment. Do you know what I mean? And obviously Scott could fight, but I'm thinking Brian, world champion. Come on, mate. Went on to be world champion. I'm thinking, it's like, and oi, Chris. Not as if like Scott's like British champion, or Tyson Fury's British champion. You think he's gonna be a world champion because that's the next process. I'm talking when there was like raw. Do you know what I mean? Scott had no fights, no pro fights. He went to be world champion. I thought, Brian, turn it in, mate. But obviously, and then bang, like that, and you think, wow. Mm. And he just calls it like that. Call it, bang. Wow. So, yeah.
There you go. Yeah.
Anyway.
A man who knew his boxing inside out. We've been missed in the sport. And
100% he
will. Yeah, anyone who knew him as well, so. Great to have the chat with you, Tom. I know you've got a busy day ahead, but we'll catch up again soon, no doubt about it. But 100%. Rest in peace, Brian Hughes, MBE.
Yes.